May the words of my mouth and the reflection of our hearts this morning be acceptable to you, O God. We praise the Lord.
Amen.
Good morning.
Certainly it was energizing and
straightforward ways. He taught with parables. He did miracles and touched the untouchable. He drew huge crowds to hear him teach and was a very public figure. Not allowing them to be comfortable in quiet rooms and behind closed doors. He challenged the order of society, and he even at times predicted their betrayal and denial of him. So I would submit he was wielding a powerful love, a public love, a demanding love, that sometimes was probably exhausting and enraging and difficult to take. I suppose that many of us have had the blessing of having friends like that, that push us and challenge us and evoke us to be our better selves and bigger selves and to graduate from being servants to becoming friends, to becoming ones who have learned and done and gone through a process of growing from your follower to being one who can turn and teach and lead. That isn't always easy to take or an easy process to go through. And so, another thing that he does is to say we should not be limited to our own group, right? To go beyond, to go outside, to go to call forth anyone and everyone who will hear the learning and hear the message. I would say, again, in CONECT and in this organizing work, we are doing our imperfect human best to follow this commandment, to live regardless of faith and race and class and geography, to come together with a powerful and public love that Jesus showed his disciples and that I think leaps out of our scriptures today. To give you a glimpse of this, I feel like there are many examples that have come through the life of our organization, but I want to tell you about one remarkable leader in CONECT and her journey through this work over several years as a model or example of this powerful public love that gets wielded when we come together. Her name is Odell Cooper. She's a longtime member of Mount Airy Baptist Church in Bridgeport and worshiped there for years, but lives up in New Haven. She came into working with us at the organization early informative days, and was most active around mortgage foreclosure issues, which were ravaging the country and the state at that time, after the economic crisis. She credits the work she did in organizing forums and opportunities for people to learn about how to save their homes and get mortgage modifications with actually being able to save their own home and get a mortgage modification that allowed her to save, keep up with payments and stay in her own home. I came to know Odell as we began working on immigrant issues, and she was one who was tough and honest, that her black church and her black community, to her perception, wasn't sure that they should be for the Latino immigrants in the organization, wasn't sure that that was an issue that she could support or that would really speak to her people, that she could bring folks out to work on. She was being honest and tough and really a powerful love. What happened is that a deacon in her own church, a Jamaican woman, let it be known that these issues affected not just Latinos, but also people of African descent and people in her own congregation. And though her skepticism was real and honest, she was transformed. She later told the story about learning how these immigrant challenges affected people in her own congregation in the effort to change laws here in Connecticut. She confessed publicly to her own narrowness as a way to overcome the narrowness of our state. It was later on, during our work on immigrant issues, shortly after the Sandy Hook tragedy, the shooting at Sandy Hook had taken place. And though we had an agenda and we had a topic, and I, as the organizer, was darned to try to keep us on task, The tragedy of Sandy Hook came up in the conversation, and shortly into that conversation, Odell again courageously said, "When people in my congregation hear about Newtown, they hear race." And the meeting stopped, and there was silence until a Jewish leader. nearly so much concern or so much press attention or so much call to action to change laws. It took that conversation, amazingly, we got back on task that night after about 10 or 15 minutes. But that conversation began a lot of earnest conversations in the organization that have informed our whole strategy on gun violence for these last several years. Tragically, that issue came to affect Odell directly just 2 years ago in April of 2016, when her son, home for a visit as a 24-year-old, was going to school and working in New York City, came home for a family weekend to go to work for her the day on Friday. That night he went out with his cousin, was stopping at a gas station to buy cigarettes, and was across the street from a pizza bar on the south end of Hamden. And two men coming out of the pizza bar saw him and thought that he was the young man they had been in a fight with earlier on that evening. They followed him out of the gas station down to two or three stoplights and shot and killed him. And so, of course, Odell's world was rocked. Her faith was tested. But she came back stronger than ever, wielding that grief and that pain in a powerful love that said, I want to do something so that no other mother, no other family, no other sibling will have to go through the pain that I'm going through now. And she helped us learn that the pizza bar was not just the source of the one shooting of her son, but the source of five other shootings and numerous other violent crimes, and led us in meeting with the mayor, police chief of Hamden, and confronting the owner of that bar, and eventually forcing his liquor license to be revoked against his wishes. And interestingly enough, when we went to Hartford numerous times to fight and present a strong case to the Liquor Commission, it was Latino immigrants who went with her and stood with her to be there to say, you were there to fight for us and fight with us once, and we want, in your grief and in your pain, to stand with you to see that your interest gets met and that our communities are safer and better because of it. So, most recently, Odell's been sidelined by some serious health issues. I don't know exactly whether Odell will begin again to work with us and make her powerful love known again inside of CONECT. The Lord only knows that, but I know that her love and her strength have been felt deeply in her family, in her church, in CONECT, and far beyond that because of her work with us and so many others. She has called forth others in her own church and in other communities in CONECT to make that transition from servant to friend, from a follower to a co-leader, to be able to take our stories, our concerns, our interests in a public way and to seek justice together for all. Martin Luther King taught that power without love is reckless and abusive, and love without power is sentimental and anemic. Power at its best is love implementing the demands of justice, and justice at its best is power correcting everything that stands in the way of love. We are tapping into a powerful love